one device to another. The cloaker will forward all the traffic to the topic represented by a small circle. So you could click on a particular topic, particular client to see all the message which has been emitted so far, have been received by the broker. So I'll just show the broker, and I have created for free, there is a try version available, but there will be so much of traffic there. So that's why I prefer to create my own account. You can just see. And I'll show you the codes. I have written the codes in Python. So as we have already discussed, in case of MQTT, there will be clients. Clients will be of two types. One will be a subscriber client. The other will be a publisher client. Publisher client will publish the data on a particular topic. And which is there on the MQTT broker. And subscriber will subscribe to that topic, which is there on the MQTT broker. And MQTT broker is basically installed on Shiftr.io cloud platform. Okay, so I'll just explain your code in brief. I think my net connection is a little bit slow. I'm sorry for the interruption. I'll just try to connect. Yeah, first, right. So on the left side, you can see this code. I assume that you all know Python, but still, if you don't know, it is a very simple language, and I'll just explain you the code. So there is we have to first install the Python client library. So for that, this is a paho.mqtt client. I have included.
Ma'am, there is a break in audio voice. Listen, ma'am. Honestly, ma'am. There is a break in voice.
By yourself, particular live. I'll just, ma'am, connect. Try to connect with the other internet once.
Yeah,
once
sure, ma'am. Sure, ma'am. Dear participant, there is a discontinuity with your internet. Meanwhile, I would like to share with you all one of the website which I have come across. This is meant for Arduino projects alone. I have shared in the chat window. This is a submission repository. They will be giving complete detail, the hardware requirement, software requirements, and the coding, and the demonstration of the project which they have developed. So this kindly note down this particular website. That would be useful for your future references whenever you do research or develop your products. So I have shared in the chat window. This is the web link which I have come across. So kindly note down. So during this kind of break, I thought of giving few tidbits. Welcome back, ma'am. Manasi Misra, ma'am. You can kindly handle the session. Am I audible, Manasa, ma'am? Hello, Manasi Misra, ma'am. I couldn't hear your voice. Actually, I made you as a co-host, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. Please continue.
Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am. Now it is perfect.
Okay, ma'am. Am I audible now properly?
Audible. Okay. It is perfect. You can proceed.
Okay. I'm really sorry for the interruption. Actually, I was facing some kind of network issues. Okay. So I was showing this code to you, and this is the publisher code, which is there in the left side. So you can see this, which I installed earlier. In the slide, I will include all the procedure to install this Pahoa MQTT client. And this is the time for time delay. I have imported this time for providing the delay in the code. Then I have used this val variable and initialized it to zero, used later in the code. Then we have MQTT server. So MQTT, we are using broker shifta.io as a broker. So this is the URL for broker.shifta.io. And you have to note down if I am installing the broker on my local system. So in that, my system here, in IP address of my server. Then we have MQTT client. So here just I'm naming this particular function is only to name the MQTT client. MQTT client underscore pub. This is the given to this. Then MQTT dot username password. I have used the privacy option in this. Otherwise, if we are making it open, so it's not required. But for privacy, I've used the authentication option. So this is the ID ETI underscore labs. This is the ID user ID. And this is the password, code password. This is the password. Then this MQTT client dot connect inside this parameter are basically broker. So MQTT server, which we have defined here. And this is the default port number for MQTT. 1883 is the default port number for MQTT server. And this 60,000 is the timeout. So this 60,000 is in milliseconds, so that means this is 1 minute.
The still next. Persist a voice break.
Yeah, ma'am, I'll just again check. Is it okay, ma'am? Yeah,
Now it's perfect, ma'am.
Okay. I don't know why today there is so much disturbance here in network. I'm really sorry for this.
Yes,
yeah. So then this is for connecting to the MQTT broker. Then this is the loop which we are going to do it again and again. That is, this is the infinite loop while true. Then here we are checking basically in the loop that whether it is connected to the MQTT broker or not. Otherwise, if it is disconnected due to any reason, like if there is any internet connection in issues, then also it disconnect to the MQTT broker. So in that case, again and again, it will check. And if there is any disconnection, again, it will connect to the broker. And then here we are just incrementing that variable. and the, using this statement, we are just printing on the local terminal. Then this is the main statement, which is for publishing. So MQTT client.publish, and inside this basic. Basic is the topic name on which we are going to publish. Then there is val variable, the variable which we have initialized here, and we are incrementing, and again and again. We are just checking here. If it is 10, then again, after that, again, it will make it zero. Then what this particular statement means, after, and then time.sleep means we are giving 2 seconds of delay. So every 2 seconds, what this particular loop is going to do, it will first check whether the client is connected or not, and then it will increment and then print on the local terminal, and then it will publish on the basic topic. It will publish, and after that, whenever it will publish from 1 to 10, and whenever, oh, sorry, yeah, 1 to 10, and after that, for every 2 seconds, it will do that, and when the value reaches 10, then again it will do it zero. So this is the code, and this we will run. And we'll check it. So as I've already told you that this is the try version. I have created my own account, so I'll prefer using it. Otherwise, you can see a lot of traffic is there. So we'll not be able to locate our particular thing. So that's why I'll be using my own broker, which I've created my own account. So here you can see that... right now you will not be able to see any kind of I'll just open my terminal and I'll run that code. First I'll navigate to the folder where I have written this code, and then I'll run this code. So due to network issues, or if there is not proper connection, so it takes some time to connect to the MQTT broker. So as soon as it will connect to the broker, then it will start printing the value which it is going to send on the MQTT broker. So here you can see this is MQTT broker, and here you can see the large circle is there. So as soon as it connects to the MQTT broker, so it will there will be a topic connected to this broker in the dark circle, which I have showed you in the slide. This one. You will be able to see this broker and connected. You will be able to see the basic. Here the topic name is hello, but in our case you will be able to see the name as basic. And the name of client here is ABCD_4 and ABCD_9, like this. And in our case, the client name is MQTT client.pub. The publisher client name is MQTT client_pub. So you can see here the client name is there, and you can see on the left hand corner upside, you can see there is world, and the world is coming actually on the hello topic. So you can see there is hello topic. If you click on this topic, so you will be able to see on the left side upside corner, you can see this particular client ABCD_7 on this time. This timestamp is there on hello topic, what it is sending, world. So this will be visible to us. And if we click on this topic, so detailed thing will be able to see. So see, as soon as it is connected to the MQTT broker, because it was taking time, because I don't have so, proper net connection today. So as soon as it is connected, it will keep on printing this. And this on the local terminal. And same thing will be visible here. So I hope it is visible to you that MQTT client_pub is publishing on the topic basic. So see, this is dashed line. It is giving the value to the basic topic. And when we click on this basic topic, so we'll be able to see the details on which time, what is being seen. Everything we can see. So everything is being shared, stored in the database. See, it is publishing. Now what we can do is, it is very, very good tool to teach the students practically. And now in the other terminal, what I'll do is I'll run the code of subscribe in the other terminal. new terminal. I'll run the code of subscribe. First, I'll navigate to the folder and then I'll run that code. MQTT underscore sub. So first, it will take some time to connect to the MQTT broker. As soon as it is connected, then it has been subscribed to the topic basic. So whatever we are publishing, it will start getting it. So right now you can see that only publisher client is there and it is publishing to the basic topic. So as soon as the subscriber client is connected, so you will be able to see that it will, whatever is publishing on basic topic, that subscriber client will be start getting it. So it is taking some time, otherwise because we are on Zoom call also, so Zoom is also taking a lot of bandwidth. So if you run the code, if you're not using anything on the net and if you run the code smoothly, immediately it will start working out. So we'll just wait for some time so that it connects to the MQTT broker. You have seen in this case that it took some time to connect to the MQTT broker. Meanwhile, I'll just explain you the subscriber code. So in case of subscriber, you can see that these statements are same and this broker statement is also same because we are subscribing to the same broker. Then this is just we are giving the name of MQTT subscriber client as MQTT client underscore sub. Then this is also the same statement because we need user ID password to connect to the broker. Then this, using this statement, message client.on underscore message, what it is doing is it is indicating that whenever anything comes on that particular topic which we have subscribed, immediately this particular function should be called, and this function is defined here. So what is there in this function is basically it will print message topic, what is the topic on which the message is coming, and then it will print this what string in the form of string. It will just print whatever is being received on that particular topic, and using this statement it is just going to connect, and this statement, it is just indicating that on which topic it has to subscribe. And in loop, again, it will just check in loop whether every time it will check the in the loop that whether it is disconnected or not. If it is connected, then it is fine. If it is disconnected, again, it will try to connect to the MQTT client. So we'll just check whether it is now connected or not. Okay, so now it is connected, and you can just see as soon as it is connected, it is printing the topic name as well as what is coming to that topic. So we'll just check in the browser. Now you can see earlier there was only publisher client, and now there is a topic, and this subscriber client is connected through the dashed line to that topic. Because this subscriber is subscribed to this particular topic. So whatever publisher is publishing, now subscriber is getting the same thing. So I hope it is clear to you, and it is a very good tool to explain student. And as we have limited time, so I cannot cover the whole concept, but there are so many things. Like you can try, I have given you the basic idea. Now you can try it with yourself after the session. That how you can do the subscriber means how you can do the hierarchical, as I have explained in the presentation, right? That you can subscribe and in this form you can try different topics you have to publish, and after that you subscribe using this plus sign and you subscribe using this hash sign. So it will be very interactive representation. You can show to the students. And whatever you show practically will be retained in their mind always. So it's very good method to show everything practically. So that was all about this MQTT protocol. And now we'll start with the, I'll give you this installation process so that you can do it yourself also. And now we'll start with the Tinkercad hands-on session. So I hope it is clear to you. If you have any question, you can post in the chat box. I'll just see if you have any question.
It's 2:30.
If code is not clear to you, shall I explain it again, or I can give this all means presentation also. I'll share the presentation to you as well as I'll share the code also. So now we'll start with the, if there is no question, so we'll start with the Tinkercad option, and you can do the hands-on activities simultaneously. So you open the Tinkercad.
Ma'am, one more participant asking you to repeat the process of that coding, ma'am.
Coding? Okay, yeah. Fine.
Maybe 5 minutes we can rewind and wrap up, ma'am.
Fine. So, I'll just briefly explain whole process. That MQTT is basically a protocol, which is application layer protocol, and it consists of mainly two types. Client and broker. Broker is mainly server only, and the client can be publisher and client can be subscriber. So publisher client is the one who publishes the message. That means who sends the message. So in context of IoT, we can say that the sensors or the sensing devices or the smart devices are acting as a publisher. Like if they want to send the temperature data, so they will be publishing the data onto the broker, shiftr.io platform, that is acting as a broker here. And then there can be subscriber. Subscriber can be our mobile devices or our laptop where we want to get the data, like temperature data. I want to get the temperature of my home. So in that case, I can be a subscriber client. So this is the code for subscriber. So see on the left side, it is a publisher code. So in case of publisher, we need to install a library first. So in the PPT, I'll share the process for installing the library, which you can do. And in this code, you can just see that this library, we are importing this library into our code as an MQTT. Paho.mqtt is library for MQTT client. And broker is already installed in the shiftr.io platform, so we don't need to do anything with the broker. So this we are importing, and then importing time just for giving the delay. And then this is the variable, just we have taken the variable, this I hope already you know. And MQTT server, here we are providing the detail of MQTT server. If we are installing the local broker, in that case, IP address will be put here. Instead of broker.shift.io, we will be putting IP address. Then MQTT client equal to MQTT.client. Here I am just naming the name of my MQTT client. You can name anything you want. MQTT client.username password. This is just for the authentication, because I have assigned user ID and password for my own account, ETI Labs account, which I have created on shiftr.io platform. So that's why this is the username and this is the password for that. And this is the statement for connecting to MQTT server, where MQTT server detail we have provided here. And this is the default port number. 1883 is the default port number for MQTT connection. Then this
Make invoice, one totally voice gone now.
Just a second, ma'am.
No audio, ma'am. Completely broken.
One second, I'll just check. Is it audible, ma'am, now?
Yeah, again, there is a disconnectivity. Another one more ice breaking session. This is the picture I got from the social media for the funny part, how the future traffic system would become. So that is what the funny part they have shared. But I could see $1 million problem, even I can say $1 billion problem exists in this picture. May I know from you through the chat box, what is the problem I'm facing, or what is the problem I'm finding, or what is the solution, as a technical, or today it is Engineers Day, wish you a happy Engineers Day. So what is the potential problem exist for engineers in this picture, and what is the way engineer need to approach this picture? I would like to come forward for the discussion thread. This is a picture. Traffic collision, excellent. Wow. Traffic collision and monitoring. Because normally we, the human being, we used to look at only the front. Looking at that rear mirror itself, very difficult for us to handle. Because during driving, we will be facing a lot of, gear management, steering management, so many brake management, accelerator, so many things. In future, if it becomes like this, collision and monitoring will become very big challenge. So that 10 direction we may need to monitor through IoT sensor. So what are all the 10 direction? East, west, north, south, then that combination of 4 more direction, and the top direction, 1 bottom direction. So all together 10 directions. So for the 10 directions, sensor need to detect based on the proximity of other vehicle which comes near. Then it's supposed to collect together, it's supposed to give the signal which direction there is a problem. Either it needs to give alert to the other vehicle or to the driver. Or I don't know what are all the name in future it will come. Pilot, driver. So many words are available for driving the different vehicle. So when it comes, we may need to give them the alert. So how exactly they need to take the diversion? This is the challenge for, I can say, perhaps the circuit department for coding and giving the solution. Whereas the mechanical, the way in which the direction orientation, that how it takes the path of driving, that is what, again, another challenge, that gear mechanism, all those things. So we do go for left and right. In future, we need to think in all the 10 directions, how to make a movement of this all. This is what I find the potential problem. So we can come up with some prototyping or simulation for this kind of thing. Then that could be patented, that could be taken into consideration for further publication or whatever. So this is what I thought of showing meanwhile. Let me check out whether Manasi has come. Manasi ma'am, could you hear me? Manasi ma'am, are you there? Hello. Yeah, ma'am.
Hello. I hope I am audible now.
I stopped sharing. You can go ahead with your presentation, ma'am.
Okay. I'm really sorry for the interruption.
Could you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah.
Manasi, ma'am?
Yeah. I can hear you, ma'am.
Again, welcome back.
Yeah. I'm really sorry for the interruption. Yeah, I hope my screen is visible.
Ma'am, do you give any audio voice? I am not able to hear. Are you talking?
Yeah. Hello?
Manasi Misra, ma'am?
Yeah, I am talking.
Are you talking? I am not able to hear you.
Actually, in chat box, I can see people are saying
audible. Manasi Misra, ma'am? We are not able to hear you anything. I am not sure whether you are talking or just displaying this slide. We are not able to hear you.
Can you please put in the chat box that you are able to hear me?
Manasi, ma'am? Not even a small bit of audio we could hear from you. 1 second. Audible and visible?
Yeah. Okay, fine.
Then I will need to check my end.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, fine. So I was just again explaining this code. So I hope publisher client code is clear to you. And anything if I need to repeat, so you can just let me know. Then now I am explaining the subscriber code. So this import paho.mqtt is the same as a publisher one. Then import time is for delay. And this is for mentioning the broker which I am using. Then this particular line is just for naming the client, which name I'm giving to the subscriber client. So I'm giving it as MQTT client underscore sub as a subscriber client. Then this particular statement is for MQTT setting the authentication. So it should be same as the publisher one because we are subscribing to the broker, which is already I've created with this username and this password. Then this particular statement is basically whenever this is a callback function, you can say this is the callback function, which is saying that this whenever the any message comes on the topic which I have subscribed to, so immediately this particular function should be called. So this is the definition of this function. So what is written in this function is message topic. So this print, it will print the message topic and then it will print the payload, whatever payload is there, which is received on that topic. And then this particular statement is just to connect to the MQTT broker. And this is just to indicate that on this topic, I'm subscribing. So on basic topic, I'm subscribing. So this is in the loop. Again, we'll check that whether we have not disconnected. If it is disconnected, then again. And it will connect. So that's it. When I have to mention anything in the while true statement. So I hope it is clear to you. Again, if it's Riku, run the code. So I'll just run the code. I'll just navigate to the folder. I have navigated. Then I will run this MQTT underscore pub code. So you can see now my connection is stable. So immediately it has started printing here. So sometimes if connection is not stable, so it will take time to connect to the MQTT broker. So I'll just open the broker and we'll just check whether we are receiving or not. So see, MQTT publisher client now sending on basic topic. So now I hope it is clear. So if we want to see the detail, here you can see left side upper corner. Here it is displaying the basic topic, means topic name it is displaying, and what is received on that topic is displayed here. And who is publishing, this name is put here. And you can see the timing also. And if you want to see the detail, then you can just click on this topic. And here you can see the details, all the details on which, at which time we have received what. So all the details you can see from here. So there is a try version. I also told you that there is a try version. Try version means in that case, you can see that try version is not limited to a particular account. It is open to all. So So there is no authentication. You can see authentication is there, but everybody knows the user ID and password. So you can see a lot of traffic is there. So if you want to use this trial version, so instead of the CTI Labs username and password, you have to just use try and try. Try will be the username and try will be the password only. So in that case, you can see your node here. But there is a lot of traffic, so that's why I've created my own account. You can also create your own account. There is easy documentation available so that you can do it easily. I hope it is clear. If anybody wants a repetition, so I can again do that. But I think I hope it is clear to you. I'll share all the slides and along with that, I'll share the code also so that you can do it by yourself. And it is a very good tool to teach the students in classroom. And it is a very interesting means. They will be able to see everything, how the process are, who is sending what, everything you can take it easily. So now we'll move to the hands-on session or Tinkercad. So you just have to open Tinkercad. So in this session, you can do it simultaneously. So first of all, you have to create your account. Not actually, creation is not actually mandatory. You can just sign in using your Google account or Facebook account or whatever. There are a lot of sign in option available. So you can just sign in. And as soon as you have signed in, so this type of screen should be visible to you. So I'll just wait for 1 minute so that all of you could open this. Now, as you open, what you have to do is you have to click on create project option. So in Tinkercad, what we are actually going to do, it is a very simple and very user-friendly platform, but it is still in development stage. So day by day, new components are being added in this platform. But for beginners, it is a very good platform and easy to learn platform it is. So you can, using this platform, what we can do is, we can easily create our project. And we can easily do so many experimentation. You can easily, like hardware based on earlier, before this pandemic situation, the labs were very easily accessible. So in that case, what we used to do is, in case of IoT based courses, generally we used to teach the students using Arduino boards. So Arduino boards were easily available in the labs. So what they used to do is Arduino coding they used to teach, and using this easily available hardware platform, that is Arduino Uno platform, they were taught either LED blinking, means general peripherals like LED, buzzer and push buttons and all. And apart from that, some specific sensors such as PIR sensor, IR sensor, temperature sensor, then actuators such as motors, fans and so many things. So, but now if in case of this pandemic situation and remotely, we are not having that liberty to use our hardware platform. So what we can do is we can have a simulatory platform where we can get the hardware available, hardware and components available, and we can connect so that it will be easy for us to teach the students that this way you can connect. And whenever they will get the access to the actual hardware, they can easily connect, do the connection very easily. They can do the connection. So, and it is also a good practice that before making any project on directly to the hardware, it's a very good practice to do it first on the simulation, make the coding and do the circuits, all the circuits. And after that, you start with the actual hardware development. So in that way, you will not damage any kind of sensors or any kind of hardware. You will not damage if you have done any kind of wrong connections. So this is a very good practice that you use a simulation first, you do the simulation first, and after that you start the hardware development process. So I hope all of you have reached to this particular point. You have created your account, and now you can, what you have to do is left side, you can see there is option, multiple option. This particular platform also allow us to make 3D designs, like 3D printing over there. No? So 3D designs also we can do. Now what we have to do is we have to create a project. So to create a project, you click on create projects. So I'll just click on a project. And you can add a description to this project. Say if like you are making a project to solve any real-time issues. So you can just add a description that this particular project is meant for this user, or this will do this thing. So the description you can add. And now you can click on this. Instead of 3D design, you have to select circuit, because we are practicing on circuit. So now you will be able to see this screen, where in this portion it is blank because I have not created any circuit yet. And in the right side, you can see there are a lot of components available. In right side, scroll, you can scroll. So many components are available here. So what we'll do is, I hope you are aware about the components. That is, this is a resistor, this is LED, and potentiometer, push button. There are so many components available. Now what we'll do is, we'll start with this Arduino. We'll drag and drop. You just have to click and you have to drag and drop this to our main screen. So this is the Arduino Uno platform. So this is a very famous and very low cost platform available in the market, Arduino Uno. It is having an 8-bit microcontroller on it, AVR based microcontroller. And here you can see there are a lot of pins available. So here, these are the digital pins. This side, these are the digital pins. It is written over here also that these are the digital pins. And these are the analog pins. Means there are 6 analog pins and there are 14 digital pins on this. And then there is ground pin. And then there is 5 volt pin, 3.3 volt pin, and ground pins, multiple ground pins are there. Then there is VIN. VIN is for this particular, like there is a DC jack here. DC jack means this particular, this is USB port. USB port means there is a USB cable, which is one side of the cable will be connected to our laptop and the other side of the cable will be connected to this board. When we are using actual hardware, this will be the scenario. So from our USB port, as you must be knowing that we get 5 volts. Generally, we get 5 volts, 1 ampere, or hardly we get 2 amperes. So generally, we get 5 volt and 1 ampere. So this signals, this particular pins will be giving. One second, I'll just check the chat. Okay. This particular, if we are making this pin high, so high means we are giving high signal. So maximum we can get 5 volt signal on this particular pins. So there are there may be possible that some sensors may be working on 3.3 volt. They cannot tolerate 5 volt. So in that case, we can use 3.3 volt signal in this case. Then we have 5 volt signal. Then we have ground for earthing, that is 0 volt. Then we have VIN. So VIN, I was explaining that VIN is this DC jack. Whatever voltage we are providing to this DC jack will be getting from here. Like say, for example, if I want to control my DC fan, which operates on 12 volt. So in that case, this particular pins cannot give me sufficient voltage, because this can give me a maximum 5 volt of voltage. So using this VIN pin, we can connect, like in this DC jack, we can provide, we can use a 12 volt adapter and we can port, use this port for that. And we can directly get that 12 volt from here, VIN pin. So this was the whole about this particular platform. The details also can be, you can, if you want to know more about this particular board, you can go to the Arduino.cc platform. From there you can get a lot of details about this board, and also you can refer to the data sheet of this board, so that you will be able to understand what this board is all about. So now what we'll do is, there are two types. There are two, basically two works which we have to do for interfacing anything. First is we have to interface that. Interface that means if I want to interface my LED with this board. So what we have to do is, we have to connect our LED to this board. And the other thing is, if I want to blink that LED. So for that, what I need to do is, I need to write a code for blinking the LED. So first of all, we'll take this LED. Now see, if you click on any component, there is an option, like you can see this option name. You can name anything. Like I'm naming LED. And then you can also change the color. Like I want blue LED. So you can keep blue or orange, green, whatever you want. So from here you can change the properties of that LED. Now what we have to do is, first program is blinking LED blinking. So for LED blinking, what we'll do is, we'll take this LED and see, when you click on this pin, you can see this is cathode or anode. So cathode is the negative one. We have to connect it to the ground, and the anode through a current limiting resistor. We will not put it as it is, because it will this LED might operate on 2 volt or 3 volt. So if we are giving it 5 volt, it may damage it, or the LED lifetime will be reduced. So it's very important to use resistor for this. So standard resistor for red LED is 220 ohms. Otherwise, we have to calculate based on the type of LED which we are using in the real hardware. We can see the data sheet of that LED and what amount of resistor we have to use. We can get from that. So now what we'll do is, we'll take a resistor, we'll keep it, and we'll change the property of that resistor. By default it is 1 kilo ohm, so we'll keep it 220 ohms. So I've changed the property. You can see I've changed, so the color coding is also changed based on that. Now I will connect. Now to connect, you just have to click on this. And you have to click it to the other point by dragging and just this. You have to make sure that terminal should be connected. Now what I have done is, I have one terminal, that is negative cathode terminal, I have connected to the ground, and positive terminal, I have through the current limiting resistor, I have connected it to the pin 13. So now the interfacing part is done. Now what I have to do? Now I have to blink this LED. Blink means for a certain period of time, I have to make this LED on. And after that, I have to make this LED off. Okay, so we'll go to the code section. So you can see on the right top corner, you can see there is option code. Now interfacing part is done. Now click on code. So in code, you can see there are multiple options like blocks, blocks plus test, and then text. Blocks is a very simple type of coding. Like we don't have to write text, any text. So this is mainly for like school kids. School kids can easily do this program. So you can see this block set built-in LED to high weight. Means in this way, we are not writing any kind of code, but we will prefer text here. So in this case, you see, this is the structure of Arduino language. This is the Arduino language. It is compatible to C programming, more of a C programming. So all the C syntax will be here. But apart from that, we have embedded systems programming as well involved in this. So that's why Arduino is based on C programming only. But it is providing us the hardware interface also. So this is the basic structure of this program. So you can see this, they have two functions, void setup and void loop. Void setup is the function which will be executed only once, and as soon as we start the program, it will first execute void setup function. So whatever we write in this void setup will be executed only once, and after that it will move to the void loop, And void loop is an infinite loop which will be continued forever. So why this type of structure is being used? Because in case of embedded system and IoT, generally we do the the same task we have to do multiple times. Periodically we have to do the same thing. So for that, we are using void loop. So now what we have to do for this? Initially, we have to set the mode of this pin, means pin 13. Pin 13 can be used as an input pin also, as an output pin also. So for what we'll do is, we will first indicate using this particular function pin mode that pin 13 is output. There can be two type of devices, either input, either output. So input is, the sensor will be in the category of input because we are sensing and it is input to the controller. The signals which are being sensed by the sensor, that will be input to this particular microcontroller. And LED is an output type of device. That say, for example, we in computers, we have what we have input devices, we have output devices. So input devices are our keyboard is input, because ultimately for processor it is input. So in that way, monitor is an output device, printer is an output device. So similarly, in case of embedded system or IoT, this LED is acting as an output device. So we have to indicate this, and sensors will be acting, or push buttons will be acting as an input device. So we have to define this mode, pin mode, in this category case. So this we have to do only once, multiple times we don't need to do it. So that's why we have put this thing in the setup. Then now void loop. So digital write, as this is the digital pin, as I've already told you that these pins are digital pins and these pins are analog pins. So as this is digital pin, so we have to put that digital write. Why we are putting write? Because we are writing onto that pin. Writing onto that pin means output. We are giving output, and we are giving output on this pin 13. And what output we are giving? High. High means to make it on. Then we are putting some delay. Delay of this delay function takes the parameter as milliseconds. So we have to, this is 1000 means 1 second. So we are giving delay of 1 second. And then again, we are writing low on this particular pin. And again, we are giving the delay of 1 second. So this way we will be able, or this particular four statements will be executed forever. So that means this is for LED blinking. Now what we'll do is, we have written the code now. Now we'll click on start simulating. Now you can see LED blinking has started. Now I'll wait for 2 minutes so that you also do this. And those who have already done, what you can do is, you can connect two LEDs. You have to connect two LEDs and you have to blink it alternatively. That means if one LED is on, other LED should be off. If another LED, first LED is off, another should be on. So alternate LED blinking pattern you have to generate. Those who have completed this, you can do the alternative LED blinking. Delay default is in milliseconds. Yeah, this delay function takes the parameter as a milliseconds only. So if you want to change the delay, like I want to change the delay, so in that case, first you click on stop simulation. I will do it for, I will make it on for 2 seconds and make it off for 3 seconds. Now you can see the difference. Now those who have completed, you can do an exercise in which you have to interface two LEDs, and this LED blinking pattern should be alternate. Means if one LED is on, the other LED should be off, and if first LED is off, then another should be on. So alternate should be there. And those who have completed the exercise, you can post in the chat box so that I get to know that you are doing it. I will again repeat the exercise. You have to interface two LEDs, and one LED should be, first LED should be when first LED is on, another should be off. When first LED is off, another should be on in that case. So alternative blinking pattern you have to do. And if you complete, you post in the chat box so that I get to know that you have completed. So I'll move to the next topic. So there is a question, can you set alarm or sound based on the data in this board? Yeah, definitely we can do this. We can use buzzer for that, and I'll explain you how to do that. How to go back to the design mode. So you click on code. So you can go there. When you click on code, then you can edit the code. Yeah, and if simulation is on, in that case, you will not be able to edit the code. I cannot write anything in the code. And for editing the code, you have to stop the simulation, and then you can write anything in the code. And if you want to close this particular box, then you again click on the code, then this will be closed. what value we can put in delay function means you can put any value to the function, but actually the delay function is based on the timer which is there on the microcontroller. So it actually based on, because Arduino is a platform which of boards, so there are different functionalities. So means another this is the Arduino Uno board which we are using. Apart from that, there are a lot of boards available. So based on the timer which is there, we can see in the data sheet that what how many bit of timer is there. So based on the timer, this delay function is being made. Apart from that, if it does not support a certain amount of delay, but generally in case of embedded system, the amount of delay which we want to put, we can easily put in the delay function. But apart from that, if you want to give them more delay, so in that case, you can use for loop also. And in that loop, you can put the delay. So that way you can make it more. So whatever syntax you use in the C, that can be used here also. Means for loop, if loop, while, everything, you can do that. So if you have completed the two LED exercise, then you can post in the chat box so that I get to know that you have done that. Okay, so it is an easy experiment. You can do it easily. And I'll just explain those who could not do it. What you can do is, you can just copy this statement and you can paste it. And instead of, in this, you have to take two LEDs, interface two LEDs similar way. You can just copy paste and whatever pin you are using for the other, another LED, you can just mention here in setup function. And after that, here also you have to copy paste, and you just have to make it one, you have to make low, and the other you can make high. That's it. That was all you need to do for this. So, okay. Now we'll move to the next experiment. That is, we'll take push button. That is, here we were taking only output. Now we'll go with the output as well as input. So we'll take push button. So push button connection is like, one second, I'll zoom it. So you can see push button connection is like terminal two. You, when you click on this thing, you it will show that what its name is, like terminal 2A. Click on here, terminal 2B. So that means actually the push button has this four terminals, but internally this terminal, these two terminals are connected. Internally these two terminals are connected to each other. They are short actually. These two terminals and these two terminals. One B and one A. One A and one B are internally connected. Two B and two A are internally connected. So that means actually we have to connect only two terminals. It appears to us as four terminals, but it we have to use only two terminals for that. Now, what we'll do is, we can take a breadboard also. Like say, if I connect multiple devices, in that case, one second. If I connect multiple devices, in that case, I need multiple ground pins. But we have limited ground pins and limited power pins in our case. So what we can do for that, we can use breadboard. So we'll take a breadboard from here. So breadboard connections are like, when you click on this, so whatever indicating in green are connected internally short to each other. So these all are connected to each other's. these all are connected to each other. And in this case, the whole line is like this, is connected to each other. So you, it will be indicated easily. So what you can do is, now this whole line is connected to each other. So push button, we can use it as it is, like as it is, we can connect it, because internally, ultimately, these two terminals and these two terminals are connected. And now we have to connect the LED also. First, we'll delete this line. Delete the connections. We will connect the LED. And what we'll do is, we will connect this ground to this pin, so that the whole, all these, this are acting as a ground pin. So now we will connect this to this pin. So LED connection is completed. Now we have to connect it to the pin 13. So LED connection is completed. Now we have to connect the push button. So how we will connect the push button? One terminal we will connect to ground, and the other terminal will connect to the pull up. So one ground, all these pins are ground, so we can connect directly to ground. And the other terminal we will connect to a particular pin, digital pin. And this terminal, through the pull up, we have to, because one second, I'll just zoom it. What is the function of this particular push button? Push button is basically, I have already told you, these two terminals are connected to each other internally. So we have practically, we have two terminals. So what is the function of push button is, when push button is not pressed, so in that case, these two terminals are open. Open means they are not connected to each other. So in that case, we need a pull up resistor, and we need to put a high signal to it through the pull up. And when this push button is pressed, so in that case, these two terminals will be short. Short means these two terminals will be connected. So in that case, whatever signal it is getting, this terminal is getting, this terminal will automatically get that signal. And this terminal, this particular terminal will give to this pin. So that means if I'm pressing this push button, so it is connected to ground. So it, this ground will be short to this, and this will get the ground, means zero. When I'm pushing the push button, so in that case, it will be getting zero. So if I'm not pushing the push button, not pressing the push button, so it is open. So in that case, it should get at least some value. So what we'll do is, we'll use the pull-up resistor in this case. We'll take a resistor and pull-up resistor. We can use a 1K of resistor, 1 kilo ohm resistor. We'll just connect it to this, and the other terminal will be connected to 5 volt. I'll just zoom it so that it will be clear to you. So now push button connection is complete. So I hope it is clear. Now we'll go to the code part. Now what we have to do in the code, earlier code was only for LED. Now that was actually output. Now push button is our input device. So in that case, we have to again define it. Pin mode. What pin we have connected? Pin 8. So we will mention pin 8. As an input. Now what we have to do, we have to read this signal. Read the signal on pin. What signal we are getting on pin, whether we are getting high or low. So for that, what we'll do, we'll use if loop. If digital read pin 8, because we are reading pin 8, right? So pin 8 equal to 0 or high or low. If it is low, so what should we do in that case? In that case, we have to make this LED off. So on pin 13, this LED is connected. So okay, fine. So now else. Else we will make it high. So this is just a if else statement. We are checking if digital read 8, that means whatever value is coming into this pin, we have to check whether it is low. If it is low, so in that case, we are writing onto pin 13 as low, and if it is high, means else, if the statement is false, that means it comes to L. So digital write pin 13 high. Now what we'll do, we'll start simulating. Now we can do one more thing to debug. Like if our code is not working, or if it is, we are not able to understand what problem is there in our code. So what we can do in that case, for debugging, what we can do, there is a serial monitor option. Here is a serial monitor option where we can print the statements to get to know where we are, our code is working fine or not. So what we can do, for that, we need to, in setup function, we need to mention the baud rate of serial monitor. So for that, the statement is serial.begin. And baud rate, general baud rate of serial monitor is 9600. Then we can do like printing statement serial.print. Whatever we want to check for debugging purpose, so we can write serial.println. See, I'm pressing the push button, but every time it is showing as high. That means this condition is not true. So I have to check whether my circuit, there is any problem in my circuit or not. I'll just check it. So using this debugging, you can easily check this. Meanwhile, you can write the code. In your system, you can write the code till then. Oh, sorry. See, what mistake I did was, anybody able to find out the mistake what I did? It was actually, I put the resistor on the breadboard. So actually it was shorting. So you have to keep that in mind. So that's why, one second. I will just put my resistor. So I hope it is clear. Like you can just see, if I'm pressing the push button, so this LED is off. And when I'm releasing the push button, LED is on. Here pull-up resistor value is 1K. So it actually depends on the type of component, the component, hardware component which we are buying from the company. So we can see the data sheet of that component, and based on that data sheet, the specification of push button we can see, or the specification of LED we can see. Based on that, we can find out the resistor value, like current limiting resistor. Based on the specification of this LED, it depends. And even the color of LED, the different colors of LED needs different type of different value of resistor. So similarly, push up pull up resistor also, based on the type of the push button which we are using, even size and what specification it has. So based on that we calculate the pull up. So you complete this one. Like, I hope you are able to see. I'll just zoom it so that it will be more clear. See, initially this LED is on. If I'm pressing the push button, this LED will be off. Now I'm releasing the push button, LED will be on. Now we can do this reverse process also. For reversing this process, I'll just check digital read instead of low, I'll just check high. For that, I need to stop the simulation and I'll just read high. So now the process will be reversed. Like initially this LED is now off. When I press the push button, LED will be on. So this is like, if like there can be a bell outside our home, and if a person is like, you can assume if a person is deaf, he is not able to listen to the bell, doorbell. So what you can do in that case, you can for an indicator, we can have a LED light in the home, and as when there is anybody outside the home, so when they are pushing the bell, so in that case the lights will be on, or lights can be blinking. So in that case, they will be able to understand that somebody is there outside the home. So this is a simple, normal use case. Similarly, instead of LED, if we use buzzer, so in that case, we can just make a simple doorbell using this very simple code. Easily we can make a doorbell. So if you have completed, you can post in the chat box so that I can know that you have done. And those who have completed, you do one exercise. You interface one more LED, and what you have to do is, initially when the push button is not pressed, then one LED should be on, another LED should be off. And if push button is pressed, so LED 1 should be off, LED 2 should be on in that case. Yeah, actually, I was not speaking anything, actually. So that's why I was waiting so that you can complete this particular exercise so that I can start with another one. So I hope it is clear to you. So I think we should now start with another experiment. So what we can do is, again, I'll explain the circuit so that those who have not been able to complete, they can complete it afterwards. You can easily complete it. It's not a big deal. Very simple code. You can see in pin mode what I have, in setup, what I have done, pin mode 13 as an output. 13, on 13, I have connected the LED. And on 8th pin, I have connected my push button. And I have declared my push button as an input. Because why? Because it is giving input to the controller. And LED is output to the controller. And here, serial.begin is just for debugging purpose. That you whatever is there, you can see on the serial monitor. And then in void loop, void loop is the forever function. Here, I am checking digital read 8. That is on 8th pin, I have connected my push button. So I'm just reading what value is coming on pin 8. So if it is high, then digital write 13 as low. That means on LED, it should give low signal. That means LED should be off in that case. And on serial monitor, I'm printing it as a low. So you can see on the serial monitor, it is printing low. It is just for the debugging purpose so that you'll be able to understand whether there is problem in your code or there is problem in your connection. So that's why I did a mistake and I just shown you. And see, if in simulation, it is easy for us to do the mistakes. But in case of hardware, if you connect it, you may lose your components. It may damage. It may cause problem to your components or it may cause problem to your board. So it's better to do whatever the connection you want to do on simulation platform, and you can make your code and you can check whether it's working fine or not, then you should connect to the hardware. So I'm just checking whether this, I'm reading onto the digital pin 8. If it is high, then it should make this LED off. And if it is not high, then it should make the LED on. That's it. So very simple code, and the connection is also very simple. LED, you've already done. And in case of push button, I've already told you that these two terminals are internally connected to each other. And these two terminals are internally connected to each other. So practically, we can say that we have only two terminals in the push button. So this terminal, one terminal I have connected to ground. And the other terminal I have connected to this pin. But we have to use pull-up register because in case when we press the push button. So these two terminals get shorted. So when we press the push button, in that case, we'll get whatever is there in this terminal, will get on this terminal also. So I'm getting ground. So when I push this button, this will get shorted and I will get zero on this. But if I'm not pressing my push button, so in that case, what should I get? This will be a floating kind of pin. So in that case, we should give some signal that is high. So 5 volt, I am connecting it through the pull-up resistor so that this particular thing should not damage. So that's why I have connected. So very simple, this is a very simple diagram. So now what I'm going to do is, now we'll connect the buzzer. Buzzer is for like, if somebody was asking that if we can ring a bell for some use case or something like that. For, you know, doorbell also, you can do this. Instead of this LED, what you need to connect, buzzer. So we'll do the same thing. I'll just remove this LED. And buzzer has the similar functionality. You can see, you can find a buzzer in this. See, there is a piezoelectric buzzer. You can get this buzzer. And move the cursor on the terminal, you will be able to see which terminal is positive and which terminal is negative. So you can do that. So what you can do is, now positive terminal, we will be connecting to the pin. So in that case, in this case, the current limiting resistor is not much required because this buzzer can, this buzzer mainly operate on the 5 volt only. So we can remove this. So positive terminal of the buzzer can be connected to a particular pin. So I'll connect to the pin 13 only. And the negative terminal, we can connect to the ground. Now we'll start simulation. So now you can see when I push the button, you can hear the buzzer sound. So buzzer is very simple. Just positive terminal, you have to connect to a particular pin, and negative terminal, you can connect to the ground. And when I'm pressing this push button, you can see the buzzer sound. So all of you can do this particular thing. So using this, you can easily make the doorbell. This push button will be there. And this buzzer can be placed inside our home. I'll just wait for 2 minutes for you to complete this. If anybody is not clear with this, you can post in the chat box so that I can, if you have any issue, I can again explain. Otherwise, I'll move to the next topic. What is the use of third pin of button which is connected to 5 volt of power supply? Actually, I've already told you, right, that this internally, this these two terminals, one second, I'll just stop simulation. These two terminals are internally connected. These two terminals are internally connected. So whenever I'm, so means practically we have only two terminals. So we can say that this whole circuit is connected to each other. So it's not like a third pin, it's like a this pin only. But what is the use of this? If I am pressing the push button, so these two terminals will be internally connected in that case. So in that case, what it will get, whatever is there, whatever voltage value is there on this pin will be getting on this pin. And this pin means this pin 8. So in that case, if I'm pressing the push button, so here it is connected to ground. So in that case, this particular pin will be connected to ground. But so if it is not connected, means if it, I'm not pressing the button. So in that case, what will happen? In that case, these two pins are open. That means if I'm not connecting this to 5 volt, so in that case, this will be like a floating terminal. There will be no voltage on this terminal. So that way we will not be able to read anything from this this pin. There will be no voltage on this pin. But ultimately we need either high or low voltage, because in when we are pressing this button, so in that case we are getting low voltage. That is very clear to you, right? Like if I'm pressing this button, this two terminals will be connected to each other. So it will be getting whatever is there on this pin, it is getting here. So low is getting in this case. But if I want to get high signal, so how I'll be getting? So that's why I have connected this to 5 volt, so that if nothing is pressed, so 5 volt should be getting. But this is pull-up resistor is just for limiting the current. That's what is use of this particular thing. Now I hope it is clear. Now if any doubt in this, so you can post in the chat box. Otherwise I'll move to the next topic. Okay, so I'll start with a new one, new topic, that is PIR sensor. Now we have done LED, we have done buzzer, we have done push button. Now I'll start with the new one, that is sensor. So I'll just open this. I will take the PIR sensor from here. So PIR sensor is a digital sensor. What is the basic difference between digital and analog sensor? Digital sensor basically convert sensor is like a transducer only. So whatever it sends from the environment, it ultimately converts into the electrical signal. So the electrical signals in which it is being converted, if it is in analog form, so in that case, that means that sensor is analog. And if it is being converted into a digital form, that means it is a digital sensor. So ultimately most of the sensor are actually analog. By default it is analog in nature, but ultimately if we are getting any digital sensor, so what is being done behind the scenes is there is a comparator there, and there is a potentiometer there to adjust the threshold, and then there is a comparator. So what comparator does is on one terminal, we can give a particular threshold voltage, which can be changed using the potentiometer, which is there on the sensor module, we can say. So sensor module contains the sensor sensing element. Along with that, it has comparator and potentiometer to change the threshold value. And the threshold value is there on the one terminal of a comparator, and on the other terminal, we have the voltage which is being converted from the sensed value to the electrical value. So we just basically compare with the threshold value whether voltage is beyond that or below that. So based on that, it will create either high signal or low signal. Say we will take an example of this particular PIR sensor. So what PIR sensor means? PIR full form is passive infrared sensor. So PIR is basically we can say enhanced version of IR sensor. So IR sensor, what it does is there will be two types of LEDs in IR sensor. One is receiver IR receiver LED, one is IR transmitter LED. So what it does is the transmitter LED will transmit the IR radiations, and when there is an obstacle in front of the IR sensor, it will go back after the collision. It will go back to the sensor, and the IR receiver will receive that, and then it will indicate that there is some obstacle in front of it. So IR sensor is that. So IR sensor is basically, if we put any obstacle, either it is a human being or it is any non-living thing, if anything is there in front of that sensor, it will sense. But PIR sensor is like, it is a passive infrared sensor. That means it don't have its own energy. Whenever any human body or whenever any body which is capable of emitting infrared radiation comes in front of this and it crosses actually, then it will able to identify that there is any movement in front of this PIR sensor. That means it will be able to detect the movement. So you can see when you click on, first we'll connect this sensor, then we'll be able to see the working of this sensor. So basically it is used for the movement detection of human body. So in that case, we'll just connect it. One second. I'll just remove this push button from here. I'll remove the buzzer also. So PIR sensor has basically three terminals. One is, you can see whenever you put the cursor on the terminal, you will be able to see the what type of pin is this particular. So this ground pin you have to connect to the ground. Power pin you have to connect to the power. Power means, see, every sensor has its own property. Means it will work, either it will work on 3.3 volt or it will work on 5 volt. So it depends. You have to, whenever you use any sensor in practical, first you refer to the data sheet of that sensor, because manufacturer to manufacturer, it differs. And also in case of like industrial sensor we use, so in case of industrial sensor, it works on some other terminologies, or it works on some other it has some other power requirement. So it's important to go through the data sheet of whatever sensor you use. Then only you try to connect that sensor. In case of this PIR sensor, it works on 5 volt. Because if some sensor work on 3.3 volt, so you may damage that sensor by giving it 5 volt. So it's very important to go through the data sheet first whenever you use any sensor in actual hardware. So ground, you can connect to the ground. I'll just remove this. So ground, signal you can connect. I am connecting to pin 12. Then power, you can connect to the 5 volt. Power, you can connect to the 5 volt, and ground, you can connect to the ground. Now I have done the connection. Now you can see by clicking on the sensor, you will be able to see the range of that sensor. So first, when we start click on start simulation, then you will be able to see the range. So I'll just zoom it properly so that it will be clear to you. See, this green thing is basically a zone of PIR sensor. That means in this zone, if you are making a movement, when you click on this blue circle, this means this is an object. Object means a human, not a normal object. PIR is capable of detecting human movement. So if within the range, every sensor has a certain range. Then within the range, if you move, then in that case, PIR will be detecting it. Right now, what we have done is maybe this particular pin is, so you can see that there is, if there is movement, you will be able to see this two red circles here. If I'm moving it outside, so in that case, after some time, it has certain time period. After that, it will just become off. And if you are moving it into the range, so it will show this two red circles. So now what we have to do is, I have explained you the working of this. Now there is an exercise. What you have to do is, if there is any movement, in that case, what you have to do is, you have to switch on the buzzer. It will be like a intrusion detection system. If anybody is there, like I can put this particular PIR sensor outside my house, and I can have a buzzer or I can have a bell inside my house. And whenever there is any movement of any person, any intrusion is there outside my house, so automatically I'll be knowing that somebody is there outside my house. So for that we can use it. So intrusion detection system is a use case which you can make. Now I am giving you the exercise that you have to, based on this, you have to switch on the buzzer. So coding is very simple, as we have done in case of push button. Similar coding is there in case of PIR sensor as well. You can easily do that. Like, this is the same coding which you can do. So whatever pin you are connecting your PIR sensor, you can just mention that pin onto this. I have tried for an automatic hand sanitizer using IR sensor and transistor, but it working in reverse order. When I switch on, it automatically flow the liquid, and when I move object to IR, it will stop. So you can just reverse your coding. You just have to reverse your coding. Like I have shown you in this example, right? So what I was doing, I'll just do it because we have less time now. So what I'll do is, I'll just do this exercise myself, but simultaneously you also do it by your own. I'll just explain you how you reverse, you can do the same thing. I'll explain the buzzer, connect the buzzer also along with this, but simultaneously you also do along with PIR sensor, you connect your buzzer, and when there is any movement across this PIR sensor, your buzzer should be on in that case. So we have to make an intrusion detection system. So all of you see, this is an example of intrusion detection system, which I told you to do in the exercise. So what I have done is, here I have connected PIR sensor. I've used the breadboard for that, so that I can get more ground and 5-volt signal. So what I have done is, I have connected this. I have connected this negative terminal to ground, and then I have connected the positive terminal to pin 13, pin 13 of board. And PIR sensor, I've already explained you the code, I have connected on the pin 7. The signal I have connected on pin 7, and power I've connected to 5 volt. I have 5 volt signal. All the pins are 5 volt signal only. So I've connected power to 5 volt and ground to ground. So what I have written in the code,
it's
is 4 same.
O'clock.
Pin mode, we have defined 13 as an output. Why? Because on 13 we have connected buzzer, and buzzer is output. And on 7 we have connected PIR sensor, which is an input. And then in loop, we are checking that pin 7 is whether it is giving low or high. So in this case, if it is giving low, so this statement will be true, and the buzzer will be on. And if it is high, so in that case, the else loop will be executed and buzzer will be on. So we will just start the simulation. See, initially, I am not making any type of movement in front of this PIR sensor. So buzzer is off. Then I'll move this. So you can see. After some time, automatically it will switch off, because PIR sensor has some response time. We can change even the sensor's response time also can be changed. Like you have seen that I have stopped the movement, but still it was on for a certain period of time. So this was the response time of actually a PIR sensor. So that also the PIR sensor hardware, if you see, there will be a potentiometer which using which we can reduce the amount of that time. So you can see within the range, if I'm making any movement outside the range, it will not do anything. If I'm making a movement within the range, then only it will make the buzzer on. So I hope it is clear to you. So it is a very good platform. Tinkercad is a very good platform. Can we set the distance to PIR sensor as we required? Yeah, you can set definitely. We have a put means if you use in this case you cannot set, because it has certain range. Like if you click on this when we start simulation, you can see that it has certain range. Like you can see the green portion is the range of this PIR sensor, and on this simulation platform you cannot change. But in case of actual hardware, there is a potentiometer on PIR sensor. Two potentiometer are there. One is for range, and another is for the response time, which I told you that for how long it should give the high signal. If even if I have stopped the movement, but for how long it should give the high signal. So there are two potentiometers, so we can adjust the range as well as we can adjust the response time of this PIR sensor. So if you have any other question, you can post in the chat box. Similarly, you can see there are so many options available in this Tinkercad, as we have limited time, so I could not cover everything. But you can practice definitely. It's very easy, and coding is very easy. You can definitely try all these sensors. There is ultrasonic sensor, which is used to calculate the distance of the obstacle. Then there is photoresistor, using which you can sense the amount of light which is there. Then we have temperature sensor, using which you can measure the temperature. So many things are there. Then there is RGB light, where we can have three lights in a single LED, red, green, and blue. You can use a combination of light also. Then we have diode, BJT transistor. Then we have gear motor for, you know, relay, or you can use relay. Either you can use motor driver, and you can use this motor to switch on or off. Then we have DC motor here, servo motor, vibration motor. So many things are there. You can see there is 9-volt battery, coin cell battery, everything you can do in this simulation platform. What is the meaning of serial.begin? Serial.begin is basically, one second, I'll just show you. This serial.begin is basically for debugging purpose. So there is a serial monitor. Serial monitor, you can see below, you can see the low values printing here. So serial monitor, if you want to debug anything or if you want to print anything on the serial monitor, so for that we have to initialize this. This is just for initialization, and inside we are putting 9600. So 9600 is a baud rate with which it is going to communicate with the serial monitor. So serial monitor has the baud rate of 9600 by default. So in code, we have to put the 9600 only. If I put something else, like I need to stop simulation. Then if I put something else like 1500, so I'll just check whether it is printing on the serial monitor or not. It should not print actually. In this case, it is communicating. I think the code is not very well written for the Tinkercad. But if you use the Arduino platform, in that case, you have to match the baud rate of serial monitor and your code. Then only anything will be printed on the serial monitor. Otherwise, if the baud rate is basically the speed with which you are communicating. So, like if I'm speaking very, very very fast pace, and you are not able to understand with that pace. So you may miss so many things. So that is, or if I'm I'm speaking very slowly, and you are you'll get irritated that you are not able to listen to this much slow pace. So this is the main use of baud rate. So it is very important that baud rate of our code and our serial monitor should be same for the proper communication. So by default it is 9600. Then only we are able to use the serial.print function. If you have any question, you can let me know. Otherwise,
yeah, please, participants, if you have questions, you can post as quick as possible. Otherwise, I will give unmute option, so you can use communication with audio note also to in order to speed up the QA session. Now you can unmute yourself. You can communicate with the resource person. You can use now either audio or text mode, whichever the mode you wish you can do.
Yeah, you can ask me either from my previous session question also if you want, you can ask me. Otherwise, any question from this session, you can let me know.
Ma'am, there is no response from the participants. So understood, okay. That they are all clear. So that, ma'am, people are asking for your mail ID. There are two members. P. Suresh is asking for your mail ID.
Okay, I'll just
if you wish, you can type there or in the chat window, anything, ma'am. Let them know down whomever wish to communicate to you. Yeah, participants, please note down the resource person's mail ID. Manasi Mishra mail ID is being shared. If you wish to communicate further for any kind of learning or correspondence, you can make use of it. Coming to the point, security perspective in IoT network, tomorrow exclusive session we are having 1.5 day. He is specialized in security concerns, data security, web security, and IoT security. The person we are bringing is a vice president. He is specialized in IoT security. Tomorrow morning, IoT storage options. Tomorrow afternoon, IoT challenges and security. So this is what the topic. I think we can shift this question to tomorrow's afternoon resource person. Kindly, please use this session, especially for this related to Arduino and MQTT protocols. So the communication is the major topic Madam has touched upon, in addition to Arduino hardware and coding related, hardware operations related things. So related to these two, you can stick to, so that a quick wrap up can be done.
Even in MQTT protocol also, like in case of HTTP, we have for secure HTTP communication, we have HTTPS protocol, right? So similarly, in case of MQTT, we have SMQTT, where there will be secure transmission of MQTT protocol based means communication. So there is an option of security in case of MQTT also.
Yeah, regarding this attendance form, yesterday it has been closed. So even I don't have, the team is different. I need to get from them and I'm sharing. Every day, 3:30 to 4 o'clock, the attendance link or feedback form is given. 80% attendance is sufficient. Today to Saturday, those who have missed, nothing to worry. Today you fill it and till Saturday, you please come and do it. Yeah, thank you, Misra ma'am. People are dropping out. Really, it was an enjoyable session. You touched upon hardware, software, and cloud, and platforms you have introduced for interactive dynamic visualization of the communication happens between publisher and subscriber. It's really exciting, because past 1.5 days, they were into the basics and the theoretical discussions. Today, it was taken a big lead towards the coding. So that was good enough for them to get motivated. Thank you for your contribution. We approached the later part. You accepted your concern to be with us. Really, it is amazing. The short
my pleasure, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am. We will be in touch with you. We will be inviting you for future associations with our B.V. Raju Institute of Technology. On behalf of CSE department, on behalf of our institution, from the bottom of the heart, I would be thanking, and on behalf of my team, that entire team, I would be thanking you. Wish you all success, participants. Thank you, madam.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It's my pleasure, and I would be happy to associate with the institute definitely in future.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Participants, tomorrow 10 o'clock, the session starts. The same link, link you can use, same Zoom link. Tomorrow morning we are starting the session with IoT storage options. Subsequently, we will be moving on to IoT web security, IoT security and the challenges. And recordings today's session shortly will be shared. Already it is connected with YouTube live stream also. Definitely that link will be shared shortly. Maybe in 1 hour the links are shared for today's session. Yesterday's session already shared into the WhatsApp group. If you are not available in the WhatsApp group, you need to join the WhatsApp group.
Not service.
Shared. Yeah. That's all. Today's recording will be shared shortly, maximum of 1 or 2 hours. We may need to upload. Feedback link several times shared. So maybe 25 times I have shared. Right from 3:20 onwards, minimum 25 times I have shared. Shalini Agarwal, it is shared right now. Please make a note of it, because I'm going to end the session. Thank you all for your active participation. Let us meet again tomorrow for the third day session, tomorrow by 10 o'clock. Thank you all. I'm closing the session. You all can leave. Thank you.